Good morning, and welcome to Hillcrest Congregational Church, United Church of Christ. It's Sunday, September 4th, 2022, and as always, whoever you are, wherever you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. This summer, we've been capping off our summer program with a four-part series on life, death, grief, and new life. And this, the fourth Sunday, we'll be discussing new life. We've sort of been exploring the themes of Lent in miniature, going through the cycle of death and grief so that we can get to the renewal that Christ promises us. And so in a sense, this is a miniature Easter during the summer. And it's appropriate, because this Sunday is Pastor Neil's last Sunday as our bridge pastor. His last Sunday to preach, and while he will always be a friend of this church and welcome here, he is moving on to new things, and so I hope that we will all get a chance to give him a proper goodbye and send off. Likewise, next week will be the first week of our brand new interim minister, Pastor Kim, who will be coming and joining us, and we will be doing an installment, so I hope that you will join us for that next week. It truly is a day of new beginnings. And so as we celebrate and as we mourn the things that are passing, I hope you will all join us in closing your eyes, feeling your feet on the floor, centering yourself in the space, and preparing yourself for worship.
This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. daily bread. This is my daily bread.
Holy Spirit, you who came to us, to the church, after Jesus' ascension, to empower us to do your work in the world, we open our hearts and our spirits to you now, that you may continue to strengthen us, to embolden us, to guide us, to teach us, to love us, to lead us forward in this worship, as we turn our attention to God and God's word in reverence and love for all God's people. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
My soul is at rest in God alone. My salvation comes from God. My soul is at rest in God alone. My salvation comes from God. Oh, God. tears and laughter, grief and joy, in ledger, trust and care. So bind us in community that we may risk and dare. Be with us when we gather here to worship, sing, and pray. Then send us forth in power and faith to live the words we say.
Exalted and hallowed be God's great name, and the world which God created according to plan. May God's majesty be revealed in the days of our lifetime and the life of all Israel, speedily, imminently, to which we say, Amen. Blessed be God's great name to all eternity. Blessed, praised, honored, exalted, extolled, glorified, adored, and lauded be the name of the Holy Blessed One, beyond all earthly words and songs of blessing, praise, and comfort, to which we say, Amen. May there be abundant peace from heaven and life for us and all Israel, to which we say, Amen. May the one who creates harmony on high, bring peace to us and all Israel, to which we say, Amen.
Psalm 98. O sing to the Holy One a new song, for they have done marvelous things. Their right hand and their holy arm have gained them victory. The Holy One has made known their victory. They have revealed their vindication in the sight of nations. They have remembered their steadfast love and faithfulness to the house of Israel. All the ends of the earth have seen the victory of our God. Make a joyful noise to the Holy One, all the earth. Break forth into joyous song and sing praises. Sing praises to the Holy One with the lyre and the sound of melody, with trumpets and the sound of the horn. Make a joyful noise to the Holy One. Let the sea roar and all that fills in it, the world and those who live in it. Let the floods clap their hands. Let the hills sing together for joy at the presence of the Holy One, for he is coming to judge the earth. They will judge the world with righteousness and the people with equity. The word of God is still speaking. Praise be to God.
Someone asked the question, why do we sing? When we lift our hands to Jesus, what do we really mean? Someone may be wondering, when we sing a song, at times we may be crying, and nothing's even wrong.
I sing because I'm happy, I sing because I'm free, 'cause eyes on the sparrow,
that's the reason why I sing.
Glory, hallelujah,
you're the reason why I sing.
Glory, hallelujah,
you're the reason why I sing.
Glory, hallelujah, I give the praise to you. Glory, hallelujah,
you're the reason why I sing.
When the song is over, we've all said amen. In your heart, just keep on singing, and the song will never end. And if somebody asked you, was it just a show? Lift your hands and be a witness, and tell the whole world no.
I sing because I'm happy, I sing because I'm free. 'Cause eyes on the sparrow,
that's the reason why I sing.
Glory, hallelujah,
you're the reason why I sing.
Glory, hallelujah,
you're the reason why I sing.
Glory, hallelujah, I give the praise to you. Glory, hallelujah.
When we cross that river to study one or more, we will sing our song to Jesus, the one whom we adore. When we cross that river to study one or more, we will sing our song to Jesus, the one whom we adore.
I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. God's eyes on the sparrow. That's the reason why I sing. Glory, hallelujah. You're the reason why I sing. Glory, hallelujah. You're the reason why I sing. Glory, hallelujah. I give the praise to you. Glory, hallelujah. You're the reason why I sing.
Jesus died on the cross. He was killed by his enemies and himself unable to put an end to this. Jesus knew what risk he was taking when he walked from Galilee to Jerusalem to bring the message of the kingdom of God. And Jesus couldn't stop the crucifixion, and neither could God. Why not? I'm sure you've asked yourself this. Why could God not end this horror? I mentioned last week that one of the reasons God couldn't end this is because God is perhaps not all-powerful. After all, God wants to be known by us and therefore be changed by us. And when God can be changed by us, God is not all-powerful. There may be also another step to this mystery of the crucifixion. And this has to do with the teaching of Jesus. We have spoken this summer several times about God's commandment that we love one another as Jesus loved us. And this is important. But when Jesus spoke about love, he also stretched what we think of when we say love one another. After all, and we read this most clearly in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus taught that it is no benefit to us if we just love our friends and pray for them. Pray and love your enemies. Now there's a challenge. In fact, the commandment to love our enemies is sometimes so daunting to us, including to me, that we often just the British writer Chesterton probably thought about this one when he wrote that the Christian ideal has not been tried and found wanting, it has been found difficult and left untried. But it was not for Jesus. He taught us how to love our enemies, and when push came to shove, he practiced this himself. Maybe he could have prevented the death on the cross. At least I choose to believe that he could have. But living by his own commandment to love his enemies, he could not force them into any other action than the one they were set upon. And thus, he had no choice but to submit himself to the crucifixion. And this was not without consequence. We read last week about the Roman centurion who looked up at Jesus as life was leaving his body and concluded that surely this is the Son of God. Without Jesus' choice to live by his own teaching, we could not have known who he truly was. And this is not a sign of weakness. Some people in this century think of Jesus as weak. It is the ultimate sign of strength, because it is a strength of conviction, of purpose, and of faith. Jesus did teach us about the kingdom of God, and we see it fulfilled most strongly in the crucifixion. And where is God in the meantime? After all, if Jesus could not have prevented his death, could God not have done it? And again, we must conclude, apparently not. And this left God bereft, just as Jesus' followers were left in shambles. They were all grieving. What is one to do? Like Jesus, I sometimes turn to Judaism for my lessons, because it is my conviction that Judaism, more than Christianity, has maintained solid and valuable traditions about how to live and how to live in community. At another time, perhaps, we can talk more about this. In Judaism, those who grieve are given the opportunity to pray what is known as the mourner's Kaddish. It is said at the gravesite during Shiva and for 11 months following the death, and then finally each year at the commemoration of the day the person died. As you heard, the Kaddish sounds like a praise psalm to God, perhaps even a little bit like Psalm 98, which we also read. There is a critical piece of distinction that I want to mention here. Because when you read the Kaddish, it expresses a hope for a future in which God's reign will be made perfect. It does not state that this has already happened. It says, "May God's majesty be revealed in the days of our lifetime." In other words, it is saying, one day in the future, may God's reign be fully revealed, and hopefully I will live to see it. For me, then, the Kaddish expresses a hope that abundant peace and life and harmony will find us, but it does not claim that it is already here. Therefore, this is not a prayer that states that God is good despite the evidence of our senses. This is a prayer that holds fast on the hope that the tragedy of loss that we are currently living through will one day make sense. But it does not have to make sense to us right now. At the same time, the community, the tradition, and my own stubborn faith suggest to me that I can still praise God and express confidence in the full revelation of God's realm that one day will come. In our Christian tradition, we speak of Christ returning. Different faith tradition than Judaism, but a similar expression of hope that God one day will bring the fullness of their revelation, the fullness of peace, life, and harmony to us on earth. Yes, God also grieved the death of the Son on the cross, and this grief met the grief of the followers who left, as we last week saw, they left Golgotha beating their breasts, crying out themselves in grief. Whatever follows from that grief over the loss of the Son, we can understand as the outpouring of the Spirit of love, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, which brings life. Grief is the energy that God mobilized to bring about the resurrection of Jesus. The Spirit of love, mobilized by the grief of God, who lost their Son, became the life-giving force that made new life possible. So, just to pause for a moment, because this is where I come to a place to remind us why we are talking about this. We are talking about new life exactly because we have lost, and we know that we will lose more. What we're seeking is life beyond the loss. And while we may know that we won't get back those we have lost, we seek something. And last week I spoke about the ways in which we seek from our loved ones that they change us. We seek from our loved ones that they impact our lives, make us better, lift us up, co-create with us a life that we cannot create on our own. And in fact, we don't really want to create it on our own. What do? The Spirit of love that fueled the resurrection of Jesus and brings new life is present and ready within you as well. Let's be clear about this. It is not just for Jesus that we have been given the Holy Spirit. It is for all our lives that we have access to the Spirit and can participate in bringing about newness and new life and peace and harmony. And where does it begin? How do we get there? By the way, before I continue, let me say, don't ever read my words and think that I suggest we jump over our grief. I spoke last week about grief. Grief needs its own time, its own rhythm, its own space, and we all do it differently. Don't ever force it. Don't ever let anybody, particularly in a church, tell you to do something else. But some moment we may be able to find within ourselves an element of praise. It begins by holding on to the remembrance of the person we lost or the thing we lost, and a stubborn refusal to let them go, a stubborn refusal to accept that they will stop shaping our lives and that the future still holds the promise of a fullness of life in which we continue to bring forth all that was good about the one we lost. I mentioned last week the Swiss theologian Picard. He wrote, "Nothing interrupts the normal flow of ordinary life so much as love." And I think that many of us want the normal flow of ordinary life to stop when we lose someone we love. Praise is the key that connects our sorrow, our refusal to accept, our deep and unwavering love, our desire to upend the normal flow of life. Praise is a stance against ordinary life that tells us to accept, to go along, to conform. Praise lifts our spirits because it focuses our attention where it belongs. We worship here on Sunday and praise God in our doxology and other songs and hymns because we remember that is the right order of things. God is first, God is central, despite what it may look like in the outside world. Here we know what it's really all about. Likewise, in our own lives, We can praise the ones who are no longer here. Jesus appeared before the disciple after the crucifixion. What did they do next? They praised God. And they didn't do so in quiet. No, they went into the public places, they went to the temple, and they praised God there, because it was that praise that would help bring about the future that they were longing for, a future in which the life and teaching of Jesus had not disappeared, but instead continued to form and shape who they were and what they could bring into the world. Jesus had not disappeared. And we know one thing for sure, that praise changed the world. That praise helped us remember Jesus. That praise holds out for us the promise of Christ's return and the fulfillment of God's perfect presence on earth as it is in heaven. To have my Father continue to shape my life, I will praise Him. I praise my Father for His boundless curiosity. I praise Him for His insistence that you stand in life with integrity and follow your own pursuits. I praise my Father for thinking independently and for preparing me for the shocks that independent thought can bring. Praise can take many forms. Words and poems and songs always work. But there are other forms. I have known people who have planted a garden in the honor of someone they lost. I have known people who created an area in their house, and whenever they would sit there, the only reason they would sit there is to talk about someone, an ancestor that they lost. I have known someone they were painting the bathroom, and they painted a line of a different color in the bathroom. And every time they enter there, they will think of the person they lost. Praise, plants, colors, chairs, tables, sculptures, buildings, all these can be forms of praise. So let me then, finally, offer this praise that I deeply believe in to send you, Hillcrest, into the future where new life is possible. Coming out of the pandemic and all that it arrested in the life of the church, Hillcrest yet has life and will bring new life for its members and for the community. Yes, we recognize that we have lost people and that we have lost life in the last few years, but we stubbornly hold on to our faith that life and peace and harmony are in our future. Praise Hillcrest for the love it shares among its members. Praise Hillcrest for the joy of service it manifests in the world. Praise Hillcrest for the faithful testimony to Jesus and his statement that how we do it unto the least of these is how we do it unto him. Praise Hillcrest for a bright future, a faithful witness to the gospel in a time of isolation. Praise Hillcrest for a faithful witness that we can love our neighbor as ourselves. Praise Hillcrest for loving God with all our hearts, all our minds, and all our strength. Praise Hillcrest for a worthy future as God's people gathered in community. Praise Hillcrest. Praise Hillcrest. But no praise can be perfect unless it ends on and affirms the one on whom we all depend. And therefore, I invite you to say this praise with me. Can you read that? Make a joyful noise to the Holy One, all the earth. Break forth into joyous song and sing praises. Sing praises to the Holy One with the lyre and the sound of melody, with trumpets and the sound of the horn. Make a joyful noise before the Holy One. Amen and amen.
In the bulb there is a flower, in the seed an apple tree, in cocoons a hidden promise, butterflies will soon be free. In the cold and snow of winter there's a spring that waits to be unrevealed until its season, something God alone can see. There's a song in every silence, seeking word and melody. There's a dawn for every darkness, bringing hope to you and me. From the past will come the future, what it holds a mystery. Unrevealed until its season, something God alone can see. In our end is our beginning, in our time infinity. In our doubt there is believing, in our life eternity. In our death a resurrection, at the last a victory. Unrevealed until its season, something God alone can see.
Let us pray. This is a day of new beginnings. Sing a new song to Adonai, who has done wondrous things. Today is a day of celebration, for as we have gone through the process of grief and mourning and wrestling with life and death, and as many of us are still going through that process, today is a day when we remember Christ's promise of new life. that in God and in Christ we are never alone. In God and in Christ, death does not have the final word. Even as we navigate the rocky waters of life, even as we wrestle with the big questions, we have that promise to hold on to. And so let us take a moment this day to celebrate, wherever we are on life's journey, to praise God and to remember the promise of the resurrection. And so we pray. In that spirit, we pray for those who seek resurrection and new life in their lives. We pray for travelers, for immigrants, for those who do not have a stable living situation. We pray for those who are sick and ill and injured, that they may find healing and that blessings may come to them. We pray for those for whom healing comes too late, that they be taken into your arms and that their families and friends who mourn are comforted. We pray for those who aid others in finding that new life, for rescue workers, first responders, and healthcare workers. Protect the work of their hands and the work that they do, for leaders, presidents, governors, and bishops, that they may make decisions that affect the lives of others with wisdom and compassion. And as always, we hold in our hearts a special prayer for those members of our Hillcrest community in need of prayer, for Kathy and Jim, for Ruth and Dennis, for Adele, and for Cambry. Lift up these prayers and lift up our individual petitions that we speak now, either silently or aloud. Join with us now, O Lord, as we speak those words Christ taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Song of thanksgiving to you, Adonai, for your comfort and support, which brings us to salvation, even in times of grief. Grief, a river that has and continues to flow through humanity since the beginning of our time on earth, calls us to the edge. And there you are, with us, as we each offer our tears to the timeless waters, learning that through you, there is salvation, new life, and life eternal. With heartfelt love and gratitude, we now offer songs of praise and our gifts to you and your life here on earth as it is in heaven.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise God, all creatures here below. Alleluia, alleluia. Praise God, the source of all our gifts. Praise Jesus Christ, whose power uplifts. Praise the Spirit, Holy Spirit. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
Let us pray. Loving God, Adonai, we shout to you the Most High with songs of praise and thanksgiving, and the rivers clap their hands in joy. Please accept these our humble gifts, that they will help to bring your promise of justice and equity for all the peoples in the days ahead. Bless these gifts and the givers to serve you and do your work in the world. Amen.
This is a day of new beginnings, time to remember and move on, time to believe what love is bringing, healing to us the pain that's gone. For by the life and death of Jesus, love's mighty Spirit now as then can make for us a world of difference. With the Spirit's daring, step from the past and leave behind our disappointments, guilt and grieving, seeking new paths and sure to find. Christ is alive and goes before us to show and share what love can do. This is a day of new beginnings.
Loving Christ, you who said, I am the resurrection and the life, those who believe in me will live even after they die. As you send us out into the world to do the work you have given us to do, help us to hold on to your Easter promise, especially when it's difficult. Help us to remember the promise of the resurrection, even as we grieve, even as we sit in all the challenges of life and of death. Bless us, the works of our hearts and the works of our hands, and help us to remember that in you we are never alone. Amen. And now I'd like to invite all of us to turn to our neighbor, whatever that means in this digital space, whether that's another being in the room with you, friends, family, loved ones, pets, or strangers, whether that means reaching out to the greater Christian community across the world or the Hillcrest community gathered in this digital space, turn to your neighbor and greet one another in the name of the Lord, saying, "The peace of God be with you," and the response, "and also with you." Please now pass the peace. The service is now ended. If you're joining us on Sunday, September 4th, 2022, I hope that you will join us in our fellowship hall for a fellowship hour at 11 o'clock. I especially hope that you'll be able to join us this Sunday to give a true farewell to Pastor Niels and a good send-off for all that he has done for our church as our bridge pastor. And a reminder that next week we are welcoming in Pastor Kim, who will serve as our interim minister. And so please, I hope you will have a chance to be there to greet her in a proper Hillcrest fashion. If you would like to schedule a special Zoom session to say hi to everyone in the fellowship hall, you can reach out to myself or Pastor Niels. You can reach me at area code 925-689-8260 or The email, lokixoc@gmail.com. And you can reach out to me for any reason. If you want to talk or if you have any questions, comments, or concerns, please do not hesitate to contact me. Thank you very much. I hope you're having a blessed Sunday, and go forth into the world with the promise of resurrection in your hearts. Amen.